Welcome to XRT On The Record. I'm Marty Lennartz. As WXRT celebrates 50 years in 2022, we're hosting a series with legendary artists, taking us deep inside the making of their most iconic albums. We start off the XRT On The Record series with the incomparable John Mellencamp and his landmark 1985 release, Scarecrow. John, welcome.
Well, thanks for having me.
Let's go together back to that time. Well, with all the themes on the album, the themes that have been given to this album, the various places that we visit with you in middle America and farms and small towns. But what really strikes you when you listen to the record now is that it is a great rock and roll record. Musically, from beginning to end, from the first strum of a guitar and Kenny Aronoff's first snare snap, wow, the record's a great rock record today.
Well, I tell you, I never look back. I never think about what has come before. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, I never do that. I'm always looking forward. That record was, I think, probably the first record that I realized that I needed to get out of my own way. Hmm. Always before, when I was writing songs, I would direct the songs. Be like, oh, I'd write a verse, and I go, oh, I don't want it to go there. So I'd take that verse out, and I'd put another verse in. And then I realized that I wasn't making the songs any better. I was just making them different, you know, and different is not always better.
First track on the record, Rain on the Scarecrow, the song that talked about the demise of the family farm. That's a serious, serious song. That still is a great rock song, but you get your message across quite well.
Well, I wrote that song with a guy that I would periodically write songs with back then, who's dead now, a guy named George Green. And George and I had known each other since we were like five. We went to the same church, in the same Sunday school classes, and, you know, the same junior high and the same grade school. We knew each other our entire lives. And George wanted to write, be a novelist. He'd always come to me and go, I got this great idea for this novel and blah, blah, blah. And he'd tell me the whole story. And then a little while ago, I go, how's the novel coming, George? Oh, I gave up on it. I just got to the point and I couldn't finish it. And I said to him, I said, you know, maybe your attention span is not that long. Perhaps, you know, maybe you should write some poetry and I can put them in some of my songs. And so George and I were just sitting around the kitchen table talking about, you know, what is happening to the small towns across America. And that's how Scarecrow developed. We sat at the kitchen table and just really kind of wrote down our conversation.
Scarecrow on a wooden cross, blackbird in the barn, 400 inch acres that used to be my farm. Grew up like my daddy did, my grandpa cleared this land. When I was five, I walked a fence while grandpa held my hand. Rain on the scarecrow, blood on the plow. This land for the nation, this land made me proud. Son, I'm just sorry, there's no legacy for you now. Rain on the scarecrow, blood on the plow. Rain on the scarecrow. Last summer, one enough to pay the loan. Couldn't buy the seed to plant this spring and farm a bank foreclosed. Call my old friend Shipman up to auction off the land. He said, John, it's just my job, and I hope you understand. They calling it your job, oh horse, sure don't make it right. If you want me to, I'll say a prayer for your soul tonight. Grandma's on the front porch with a Bible in her hand. Sometimes I hear her singing, take me to the promised land. When you take away a man's dignity, you get workers, fields, and cows. Blood on the scarecrow, blood on the plow. Blood on the scarecrow, blood on the plow. Blood 97 crosses planted in the coal ash yard. The 97 families who lost 97 farms. I think about my grandpa, my neighbors and my name. It's enough to feel like dying. Like a scarecrow in the rain. Rain on the scarecrow. Blood on the plow. This land for the nation. Hey, this land made me proud. Son, I'm just sorry. There's just memories for you now. Rain on the scarecrow. Blood on the plow. Rain on the scarecrow. Blood on the plow. Rain on the scarecrow. Blood on the plow. This land for the nation. This land made me so proud. Blood on the plow, rain on the scarecrow, blood on the plow.
So when you started writing the songs for Scarecrow, did you go into it with, I've got to write a record about small towns and farms going away? Or was it, or did it come from the songs?
Yeah, it came from the songs. Mm. No, I didn't. I didn't really have anything in mind. I was coming off of Pink Houses, and I learned quite a lot playing the song Pink Houses. If you present a theme to a song and you wrap it up in an icebox, mm-hmm. people will sing along, you know, not that my songs are meant to be sang along with, but I had discovered that it doesn't hurt.
Let's listen to a song you wrote for your grandmother, Laura. You were very close to her. And on the album, it's her voice we hear singing the song, Grandma's Theme.
It was a dark, stormy night as a train rattled on. All the passengers had gone to bed. Except a young man with a baby in his arms sat there with a bowed down head. The innocent one began crying just then, as though its poor heart would break. One angry man said, make that child stop its noise, for it's keeping all of us away.
You're listening to XRT On the Record with John Mellencamp. We're telling the story now of the iconic and landmark 1985 album Scarecrow, another song that gave the record its identity and, in a way, for many people, gave you an identity. And I know that you, most times, you've said, write songs from an observational place. They're songs not about you, but it's kind of hard to separate yourself from small town.
Yeah, and I don't mind. I don't mind. I've never really wanted to be part of anything anyway. So the idea that I was separated from, you know, what was hip or what was in the moment or in the pop culture, I never really wanted to be part of that. My wife of 20 years, Elaine, said to me at one point, I was talking to her about it. She goes, John, you're a pair of blue jeans. Just stay a pair of blue jeans. You know, don't try to follow any trends. You know, you don't need to do that. And she was right, and I took her advice.
Yeah. Well, it certainly puts you in the place where you live and the place where you've grown up. But writing the song, that came to you by pecking away on a typewriter, right?
When I write, particularly back then, and even today, if I write on with pencil and paper, my handwriting is so atrocious that I've got to immediately find somebody to put it down on a typewriter or type it up for me, not typewriter, but on a computer, because I can't read my own handwriting. Because, you know, a couple of days go by and it's like, what the hell? What is this? What am I trying to say here? What's that word? Because I can't spell either. So, everything is kind of written in Mellencamp abridged cliff notes scribble. So at the time, somebody thought it'd be a good idea if they bought me this computer typewriter, this electric computer typewriter that dinged every time you misspelled a word. Of course, it didn't show you the correction. It just identified that you had misspelled a word. And I wrote that song in the laundry room because there were a lot of people in my house, and my wife and my kids were all in the kitchen, and there was a lot of noise going on, and they had friends over. And that voice said, hey, you better go write these words down. So I went downstairs and went in the laundry room, and I was just typing it, and they could all hear me writing the song. It was just like, click, 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 ding, 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 click, 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 ding, 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 ding. And I could hear them up there laughing, you know. And I knew what they were laughing about. They were laughing about me misspelling all these words until I went upstairs and I said, oh, you guys think it's funny, huh? And I was being lighthearted about it. And I said, you guys think it's funny? Well, listen to this. And I played them Small Town, and they just kind of all went quiet.
Enough to say, look who's in the big town. My bed is in a small town. Oh, that's good enough for me. I was born in a small town, and I can breathe in a small town.
One true line, and the line that goes through that song to this day in my head, well, there's not much to do in a small town except settle low scores. That was the first true line You know, you got to have that one true line to get started.
Right. And the line that stands out to me, too, or it's not even a line, but it's more of like a feeling that I get from the song, that small town may not be for you, but, man, it's the best for me. It's the best place for me.
What I have discovered since then is that no matter where you're at, you know, like I have a small place in New York City, and the area I live in is a small town. It's still in New York City, but everybody knows everybody in that couple block area, you know, same in Los Angeles. I mean, you know, you live in Pacific Palisades in Los Angeles, everybody knows everybody. And so really, you know, America is made up of a bunch of small towns. Some of them are jammed together in big cities. I'm sure it's the same in Chicago. I mean, you know.
Oh, it definitely is. Yeah, it's a city of neighborhoods for sure.
That's right. That's exactly right.
Yeah.
That's exactly right. And I think that's why that song connected with so many people.
This is XRT On the Record with John Mellencamp. We're talking about the album Scarecrow, Minutes to Memories, the story of the two fellas on the bus. The whole record is vivid storytelling, but this one really stands out to me.
Well, again, that was a song that I co-wrote with George. Mm-hmm. George was a good storyteller, and but he really had a short attention span, as I mentioned. So what would happen is that after we wrote Scarecrow, George would start writing these big, long poems, and then I would take the poems and dissect them, and then I would always write the choruses, because he didn't understand choruses at all. And the one thing that I had, and still do have, is that I'm really good at writing melodies. Why? I don't know. I don't know why I'm good at writing melodies, but I am. And so it was a very unique but very easy process to write with George, because I'd get these great big long, really prose is what it was. And then I would go through and I'd take that line, I'll take this line, I'll take that line, I'll take this line. Then I'll put this line with it, put that line with it, and then I'll write the melody and the chorus. And that's how Minutes to Memories was written.
When you realize that the narrator of the song is actually talking to his own son.
Yeah.
That's devastating, man. That's great.
Well, those things really were us, again, getting out of our own way.
Mm-hmm.
You know, songs like paintings are never really done. They're only ever abandoned. Because it's not like George and I were the two smartest guys in the room. We weren't. But that song's really, I think, pretty smart. Minutes to Memories. I still like playing that song.
On a greyhound 30 miles beyond Jamestown, he saw the sunset on the Tennessee line. Looked at the young man who was riding beside him. He said, I'm old, kind of worn out inside. I worked my whole life in the steel mills near Gary, and my father before me, I helped build this land. Now I'm 77 and with God as my witness, I earned every dollar that passed through my hands. My family and friends are the best things I've known. His son, it sounds like rattling old bones. This highway's long, but I know some that are longer. I sun up tomorrow, I guess I'll be home. Through the hills, Kentucky, across the Ohio River. The old man kept talking about his life in this town. He fell asleep with his head against the window. Said an honest man's pillow is his peace of mind. This world
I do things my way and I pay a high price. When I've been back on the old man and the bus ride, now that I'm older I can see he was right.
This is XRT On the Record with John Mellencamp. We're taking a look today at the iconic and landmark 1985 album Scarecrow. Well, like on Lonely Old Night and other songs on the record, the drumming to me, it snaps and it sounds like Motown. It sounds like that Motown crack, almost that snare. And listening to Lonely Old Night, a line of lyric that I hadn't really noticed before is where you drop... Standing in the Shadows of Love. There's a line in the song, and you know, with that sound in my mind and mentioning the Four Tops,
you know, I think a lot of, not just my records, but a lot of records and songs stand the test of time, or they just don't. You know, they might have been popular in the moment, but if you've got a song that has drums that go bing 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 bing, you know, and had that synthesizer sound to them, you just don't hear them anymore, you know, because it was, it dates the songs. So what, you know, we were trying to do with Kenny, and Kenny, I don't know that I wrote Hurt over Kenny because he was a jazz drummer, and I wrote Hurt over him a lot, I think, which he resented. But it was like, Kenny, you know, boom, boom, crack. You know, you're putting too many notes in here. This is not a jazz song. And I remember telling Kenny to turn things around. You know, because when you do cross-sticking, I know you probably don't know what that is, but cross-sticking is where the drummer takes his right hand and plays the hi-hat, and then with his left hand, he hits the snare drum. That's called cross-sticking.
Mm-hmm.
I said, stop cross-sticking. And he went, what? And I said, turn it around. Hit your hi-hat with your left hand and hit your snare with your right. He goes, I can't do that. And I said, hey, Kenny. He goes, John, I didn't learn how to play drums that way. I go, that's the point. Kenny, you're going to be trying so hard just to keep the beat that you're not going to have time to go boom, 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 every measure. So, you know, by the time we got to Scarecrow, he had mastered it.
Yeah.
He had mastered it. That all started on American Fool. On Hurt So Good was when I told him that. I said, man, would you stop? It's just too busy. You're too busy. And then he would, you know, when he left the band after 20 years, he would go play on other people's records, and they would go, hey, play the same thing you played on Hurt So Good. So he kind of lost, you know, anybody riding Hurt over him. So I never thought he sounded as good on anybody else's records as he did ours. And I think he'd probably tell you the same thing, you know, getting out of your own way. In other words, don't try. Don't try so hard.
She calls me up and she says, baby, it's a lonely old night. I don't know, I'm just so scared and lonely all at the same time. Nobody told me she was gone. I knew we'd work it out in our own way.
love, I guess it feels awfully long.
She says I know exactly what he means. Yeah, 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 yeah.
And it's a sad, 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 sad feeling when you're living on those in-betweens, but it's okay.
It's a lonely old night. Can I put my arms around you? It's a lonely old night. Custom made for two lonely people like me.
This is XRT on the Record with John Mellencamp. We're talking about the Scarecrow album from 1985. My name is Marty Lennartz. So you're on stage and you hear Ain't That America coming back to you. Did you feel that the audience was kind of missing the point a little bit?
I never really took myself real seriously.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point in my life, I didn't care. It was just like, just as long as they were responding.
Right.
You know, and as time went on, it was kind of like, you know, when different people running for office wanted to use that song, I would go, have you guys listened to the words of this song? I mean, you know, a friend of mine, John Prine, and I, one time were talking, and John said, you know, wouldn't it be nice if we could find just one person to listen to the Third Star songs? Just one person. Just listen to the words. That's all we need. Is one person, just please listen to the words. And not just, you know, casually, you know, have it on the radio as you're doing your laundry.
And I run through this life, sometimes it breaks my heart. Seen old people gone downtown, stumbling their way through the dark. And this little baby's cry for the hell mother's wall.
Underneath the tree, you wonder what happened to the golden face.
You're listening to XRT On the Record with John Mellencamp, doing a deep dive into his Watershed album, Scarecrow, as part of XRT's year-long 50th anniversary. I'm Marty Lennartz. Kenny Aronoff's drumming, I think, just really stands out.
We started with Kenny's drum sound during a record called American Fool in like 81 and 80. Most drums were recorded in what they call drum booths, and they were little rooms, and the drummer would sit in there so that his drums would not bleed onto the other instruments. And what it did was it made the drums not exciting. It kind of deadened the drums. I mean, you listen to all those records that were hit records or from that time period before 80s in the 70s. The drums are so dry and they're so, you know, bum, 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 bum. You know, they didn't really capture what real drums sounded like. The only thing that we knew was, let's come up with a drum sound that sounds like real drums. Now, today, it sounds, you know, normal. But back then, it was radical.
Sky. Justice will get you in the vengeance of life.
I'm Marty Lennartz, and as WXRT celebrates its 50th anniversary this year, we're talking to legendary artists about their landmark albums. Our debut XRT on the record is with John Mellencamp, going deep on his benchmark album, Scarecrow. When we come back...
I protested and acted kind of prickish about even putting it on the record, because I thought it was too much of a cartoon song.
That and the rest of the Scarecrow album from John Mellencamp as XRT on the record continues. Welcome back to XRT on the Record with John Mellencamp as we delve into the 1985 release Scarecrow. It's me, Marty Lennartz. This is the first in a series of music and conversations with legendary artists about their iconic albums that make up the very fabric of XRT. Tonight we're spotlighting John Mellencamp's opus Scarecrow. One of the sweetest songs, and a song I really, really like, and it's the song that you did with vocal help from Ricky Lee Jones. It's A Laugh and a Tear. Man, that is a beautiful song.
Yeah, I always liked that song, too. Matter of fact, I had a tour that was supposed to start this January, and it was on the short list of being played live, which I haven't played it live in years.
Hmm.
Yeah, I always liked that song. Yeah. That might be my favorite song off the record.
No longer amuse you. Yeah, yeah.
It's such a nice story song about a couple who are growing together and wanting to keep growing together and not calling it quits. You know, that's nice. It's, I know that some people have drawn the connection between this song and Jack and Diane, like Jack and Diane the later years, you know, to take a look in the mirror at themselves and say, look, we've got to keep trying. It's nice.
Yeah, and sometimes, but what's the line that's as good as it can get for us? We were fed a line of bull when we were younger, at least I was, that if you did this, and this, that you would find happiness. But it turns out it's not true. It's another illusion, you know, smoke and mirrors story that they told us. I find that if I laugh out loud once during the day, I've had a good day. So happiness is not guaranteed. And a lot of people get really, they give up on trying to be happy because it's too hard. You know, it's too hard to be happy. It's easier to be drunk. It's easier to be, you know, stoned. It's easier to be, you know, whatever their vice is. Mm. They just quit. And I find that true with, you know, most people, a lot of people, but people just, it's in our nature, I think, to give up and just go, yeah. I can't do this anymore. Mm. And I know that I've done it a lot. You know, I just can't do this anymore. I'm not going to do it anymore. So, you know, I'm not pointing a finger at anybody. I'm just think that it's part of our nature. That when the going gets rough, most people quit. Scarecrow. You know, we had made enough records that we realized, you know, we knew a little something about being in the studio. Not a lot, but a little. Because don't forget, when I got my first record deal, I had never written a song. I, you know, the idea of writing a song was like, why? I'm a singer. I'm a singer in a bar band. you know, why do I need to write songs? There's been so many songs written already. If I started singing today, I couldn't sing all of them if I sang the rest of my life. Why do I need to write songs? You know, and that really was my mindset when I got my first record deal. So learning how to write songs, I did that in public. You know, I grew up in public as a songwriter. And, you know, some guys, you know, were just, you know, born songwriters. I mean, you just listen to, like, Elvis Costello's first album. It's like, it was great then, it's great now. You know, you listen to Bruce's first album. It was great then, it was great now. You know, but for me, it was, I was Sisyphus, you know. I was always pushing the rock up the hill to find out that it had rolled down back to the bottom at night. So I had to start over.
It's XRT on the record, talking about John Mellencamp's landmark recording, Scarecrow. You finally learned how to use the studio, and that was your studio, a studio that you built. Did you build that between Uh-Huh and Scarecrow, like in that couple-year period there?
Yeah.
That was Belmont Mall, right?
Yeah, Belmont Mall. There's nothing in Belmont. There's nothing there. There's nothing there. I mean, there used to be like a little restaurant and a little hotel, but now there's nothing there, which actually was, you know, part of the inspiration for the Scarecrow record.
We, sure.
You know, I was wondering why all these little towns that I used to haunt as a high school student, you know, go over and chase with girls, they had, like, you know, closed up. And I couldn't understand why. You know, what has changed in the last 10, 15 years?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I found out that it was, you know, all the laws and all the embargoes and all that stuff that the small American farmer was being used as a pawn with other countries. And then all the laws that were being passed were to help corporate farming and to kind of eliminate the small guy.
I've seen the Rolling Stones, forgot about Johnny Rotten, saw the Who back in 69, saw Bobby Seals talking to the Panthers, saying just what he had on his mind, saw Marlon Brando on a motorcycle, was acting out rebellion, I saw Rocky Stallone in an X-rated movie. For anything, yeah, yeah, yeah. Woo.
but the Midwest is mine.
This is XRT on the record with John Mellencamp talking about the legendary 1985 record Scarecrow. I'd like to talk about a song near the end of the record that was a huge hit, R-O-C-K in the USA. That's a song that you weren't sure should be on the record, right?
Oh, no. I protested and acted kind of prickish about even putting it on the record because I thought it was too much of a cartoon song, you know. I was in Los Angeles. I was talking to, I won't mention the guy's name, but he was really frustrated with me. I just said, no, I'm not putting it on the record. I think it's too light. As we've already got a song. I think Rudy Toot Toot is on there. So take your pick, Rudy Toot Toot or R-O-C-K in USA. Which one do you want? We want both. And I went, you can't have both. So just pick one. And the guy finally looked at me knowing that, you know, back then what kind of guy I was. He goes, I'll tell you what, I'll arm wrestle you for it.
Ah.
I go, what? He goes, I'll arm wrestle. If you beat me arm wrestling, I won't never talk to you about R-O-C-K in USA yet. I said, okay. And I just knew I could take him, right? Well, he took me. And that's how the song got on the record.
We're talking with John Mellencamp. This is XRT On The Record. The album Scarecrow is what we're going deeply into today. When the album was released, Farm Aid happened the next month. Did you know about Farm Aid while you were making this record, or were you contacted about Farm Aid later?
Willie Nelson had just played in Bloomington, and he was playing golf with a couple guys that knew me. He was talking to these guys, you know, he says, I'm thinking about putting together a concert for the American Farmer. And they just said, well, you know who John Mellencamp is? He goes, yeah. And he goes, well, he's just made an entire record about that. But they gave Willie my phone number, and I was in Bloomington. And out of the blue, he called me and said, hey, it's Willie Nelson. I had never spoke to Willie, didn't know him. And would you like to help me put together this concert? I understand you've got a record that's about exactly what the concert should be about. I go, well, I don't know that I do, but I'd be happy to do it. And then the next day I got a call from Neil Young, who said that Willie had contacted him. And the three of us sort of worked together and tried to put together Farm Aid. I understand that the record company and my guitar player Mike and my engineer are remixing Scarecrow. Mm-hmm. And because they asked me, did I say, I'm not doing that. I'm not going to go back and remix that record. That record's done, and it sounds the way it sounds. And there's no bass on that. There's no bottom end on that record. Mm-hmm. But you know, at the time, it was a different sound. But you know, apparently they're putting bass, they're turning the bass up, and they sent me one. They sent me Minutes of Memories, and it was like, Jesus Christ, that sounds good. It sounds like it was just recorded today.
With your daddy's jewels and his car. And I don't like it when I hear you talking about your ex-boyfriend, the movie star. But what I like is when I walk you home and let me hold you tight. But I don't like it when I hear that you learned it.
All these songs I write are all just little folk songs.
Yeah.
And Pete Seeger said it to me best. He goes, John, keep it small and keep it going. And that's what I tried to do.
Wow. Well, that's great. We're so happy that you spent some time with us today and that you're keeping it going.
Actually, I'm thinking about going in the studio this spring and in starting a new record. I've written a couple songs that I think are pretty good. And these records that, you know, guys my age make, you know, they're just really postcards. Now, I don't really expect to sell any because, you know, my generation has long, you know, are not enthusiastic about music the way they used to be. And so many people think they have the best Bob Dylan records, the best Rolling Stones records, the best John Mellencamp records. They've already got all those records.
Right.
You know, and they can't imagine that that there would be any more good ones left. But there are.
Yeah, they're shortchanging themselves.
Yeah.
Well, congrats and all the best, you know, moving forward. And thanks for going back in time with us to talk about this record today. We really appreciate it, John. Thanks.
Thanks for not growing up.
This has been XRT On the Record with John Mellencamp, examining his brilliant 1985 album, Scarecrow. We have to send out a big thanks to Grammy Award-winning Rock and Roll and Songwriting Hall of Famer John Mellencamp for his insights into his much-loved record. Continue to join us as we celebrate 50 years of 93XRT in 2022 with more stories behind the landmark albums from legendary artists. XRT On the Record is produced by Chris Swake. I'm Marty Lennartz. Thank you for listening to 93XRT, Chicago's finest rock.